Level Unlocked, shouting at Sunday service. New level unlocked, shouting at when women worship. New level unlocked, shouting in advance, leading ladies.
Praise the Lord. I just praise and thank God for an opportunity just to share my testimony, speaking on advancing in 2021. I can think back 2 or 3 years, even more than that, when my pastor asked me and told me at the same time, you know, to start CAMS. And when I opened my mouth to say no, the word yes came out. And even going along in my studies and doing more in my church body and everything, I learned to, in order to push forward in advance, was to not make plans. God says He knows the plans He has for us. That scripture is embedded in my heart because His plans are what advanced me. I was able to get my exhortance license in 2018, glory to God, and I still have more on my journey. I married a pastor. Who would have known? That was not in my plans. In order to advance, I had to put my plans aside and move along with God's plans, His will for my life, line up my will with His. And now we are district overseers, not in my plans. I thank God for all these things He's given me and how I stay humble. I thank God for my most important ministry, being a wife and a mother. God has great plans for us, and in order for us to advance, it can't be our plans. We have to stop our plans and go with God's plans. God bless you all in Jesus' name.
In New Jersey, look what I got today at church today. My box came. I'm getting ready to go home and check it out. Jersey women, let us not come out too relaxed for our 2021 advance in victory, but let us come out ready to attack the devil. I'm ready to attack and poke him in the head with my palms.
From my oldest pair of shoes, my newest pair of shoes, I'm ready to advance in victory with the women of New Jersey. Just 1 week to go. Hope you're ready. Hope to see you there.
Yeah. Wow, did you see Pastor Jamie's video that she did about the different stages in her life? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. And so I want to announce that Pastor Jamie Bradham has won our conference box video contest. Ooh, come on. That was so powerful. She just showed the different phases of her life and how she advanced through each one of those phases, even losing her husband and taking and then choosing to become the pastor of the church and to continue to lead their church into victory. And she's making choices to continue to advance in 2021. And she is an inspiration to me and an inspiration to so many others that have been in New Jersey for much longer than I have. But I just want to tell you, Pastor Jamie, I see you and God sees you and we celebrate you. And thank you for participating in the Conference Box contest. And now, what was I going to say? Also, as Pastor Rhonda was talking, there, I got a few of the conference. I'll leave that for later. I want to know, I think we have his tabernacle, the worship team here. They did the song Stepping Over that we heard earlier. We're gonna have them again. And I want you to come on. We're going to focus. We're stepping over. We're decreeing and declaring. And then the next voice you'll hear again is Pastor Rhonda. Congratulations again, Pastor Jamie. Great job.
Thank you for giving us the opportunity to come into your presence, Lord. I thank you that we're stepping over this morning, Lord. We're stepping over the boat and onto the water in faith, Lord. And we know that it is impossible to please you without faith, Lord. So thank you for giving us the opportunity to please you, Lord. I thank you that every single person that steps out in faith this morning will see their miracle in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. I left my fear on the boat, and I relinquish all control to the one who makes me whole. Jesus, the Savior of my soul. I hear you calling me. I hear you calling me. So I will walk on the face of the water. No wind or waves will cause me to falter. No doubt or fear will keep me away from you. My eyes are on you.
Raging, but I see.
on you.
Are you ready to keep advancing? Give me, there we go. Okay. Now you can hear me. That's awesome. Woo! Are you ready for the word to keep doing work on us? We are coming out and coming through whatever's been holding us back and whatever's been keeping us down. We're advancing in victory every single day. Now in this session, I want to get so super practical because we can know, we can hear what we're supposed to do and know what we're supposed to do and not know how to do it. And that keeps us from advancing with not knowing how. The word of God says that my people perish for lack of knowledge. Ooh, hold on. Sorry, I forgot to turn my other box on. There we go. Okay. The word of God says my people perish for lack of knowledge. So we can know what to do, but not know how to do it. So I want to get super, super practical because I don't want you to leave another conference with a bunch of information that you said amen to and you walk away not being able to change or and wanting to because you know, wow, that was so good. That was such a great message. I needed that, but not making actual change. So I'm going off the chapter in the book Victory Every Day that's titled Practice. And we're going to title this practice slash action. So in practicing, the Switzerland is known for producing top forming tennis players. Like just the best of the best come from Switzerland. So what do they do to produce the best of the best? Let's look at what they do because if somebody else has already mastered it, let's figure it out. So with their practicing, if they have a bad swing on their tennis swing, they don't just redo the swing to practice. You know, you would think practice makes perfect. So you just get out there and you just keep swinging. You just keep swinging. You know, if you gave up and you want to try again, you just get out there and you swing again, right? No, absolutely not. What makes them so successful is they break it down. They break the swing down. So they start with how they're gripping the racket. So if the first time they swung and it didn't work, they're going to stop the next time and look at the grip. They're not going to just re-swing, and then get frustrated because nothing's changing. Nothing is going to change until you change what you are doing. You have to change what you are doing. And I know that takes concerted effort. It's not automatic that we change what we're doing because we've been doing it for so long. It's what we're taught. It's what we've seen. It's the only thing we know. Maybe you've never seen what God's called you to do. Nobody else is doing it or nobody else is sharing. So God is going to give you the wisdom that you need to do you, to do what God's called you to. His word says, if you lack wisdom, ask and I will give you the wisdom. So if you don't know how, the first step is to ask God, Lord, I don't know how to do this. And this is how I've lived every day of my life. I've lived beyond my own ability. Listen, I am absolutely nothing. I come from nothing. I am nothing. I've known how to do nothing that I've done. I just have been obedient to say yes to God. And when I say yes to God and I ask him for wisdom, he teaches me how, and he will teach you how to do what it is he's called you to do. So we're not just going to keep re-swinging here. I'm not just cheering you on and standing you up and pushing you out there to re-swing. I don't want you to re-swing. I want to break it down so much that you learn to take a different grip. That same grip that you've been taking on that racket isn't working. You're stuck there. It's kept you in that place. Take a different grip. So then with a different grip, try again. And if the next time is, then you take the grip and then you take the drawback. You're not even going to fully swing. They break down the practice of a swing into so many steps. Grip, drawback. And then after they check the drawback, then the follow through. So I'm not telling you today to just get back up and do it. I'm saying we're going to change. We're going to change in order to advance in victory. And we're going to break it down so simple and so practical that you're going to be able to take a different grip, different drawback, where your eyes are focused on, where your body position is, where the swing forward is, every single step we're gonna pay attention to today. So the Lord has really been speaking to me about this breakthrough of action. Because something that's happened in the church and with even maybe some of us, and I even know with myself, it actually came through a conversation with somebody. They were like, man, I'm reading the Word of God more than I've ever read the Word of God before. How come I can't get victory in this? Whew, that's such a good question, isn't it? And that can be frustrating. That's like that reswinging over and over again. The Word of God is so clear. It is not just enough to know it. And I think knowing it actually keeps us from victory. You know, when you're telling your child something or even an adult sometimes and their answer is, I know. Yeah, you get me there? I know. That's what we do. That's what we do to God and His Word. We're like, yeah, I know that. I know what that says. And it keeps us from actual action. So it almost is like something that's working against us, the I know it. God is calling us to not just know the Word, but to actually act on it. And I want to break that action down so simple and so much. Like the scripture that says to take every thought captive, right? The Word of God tells us to take every thought captive and make it obey the Word of God. So, wow. I want to do that, right? You want to do that. We want to take every thought captive. The way to do that is to break that down into such simple, simple steps. And that is, in order to take a thought captive, first, we need to measure how we're receiving it. Before it even gets in our brain, how we're receiving it. In 1 Corinthians 13, it tells us to believe the best. So are we believing the best about that scenario when we hear it? Or do we have a preconceived idea based on maybe the person's reputation, what they've done in the past? We're now receiving what's been said in that slight. With that in mind, when the Word of God tells us to believe the best, to believe the things that are of good report in Philippians 4, it tells us, think on things that are good and lovely. So when that word, something that comes in that's negative, it could be a doctor's report, it could be somebody's words, it could be something that's happening. Pay attention to how first you're even receiving it. Believe the best case scenario, because the Word of God tells us in Romans that He's going to work everything out for your good. So no matter what is being said or done, let's receive it first with, I know this is going to work out for my good. I know, and it literally changes how you receive what's being said, how that trouble that's coming gets processed through you when you receive it through the lens of, I know it's going to work out for my good. I know no weapon formed against me shall prosper. So when we receive it that way, we win. We've started the process of taking those words captive. Taking that thought captive and making it obey the Word of God. So now when somebody comes to you with that juicy bit of gossip, you're going to be like, well, maybe they're just having a bad day. Because you know what? You've had a bad day before. How have you acted? Maybe that person's having a bad day. Maybe their dog died. Maybe their family member is sick. Maybe something's going on in their life. What if we received every negative thing that was coming in that form? What if we receive that doctor's report? No matter what that says, I know that I'm healed and whole and God's going to do a miracle in my life. What if we, before it even got to get inside of us and set in there, what if we stopped it at the moment that we filter it through? And when it goes through the filter of the Word of God and the filter of love, then we know when it gets inside of us that we can meditate on the Word of God. And it will walk us into a place of victory. So taking every thought captive isn't just, yeah, I'm going to take every thought captive. It's we're going to stop it before it even goes in, and we take it personal. We make it about us. We make everything that happens about us, like how this affects us or how this affects me. What if we just stopped it before it even got to go through our process and just believed the best about that scenario? Believe the best possible outcome was going to happen. Listen, that in itself is going to change the result, because how we respond makes the difference. And as children of God, we're to respond differently. We're not to react and respond the same as the world does, because we have a different result than they do. It's a promised result. Listen, do you believe the word of God is true? The word of God is true. And it means it's true for you in your very real situation, your very real circumstance. The word of God is true for whatever it is you're going through, whatever is happening in your life. The promises in the word of God are true and they are for you, but they are not automatic. They don't just automatically happen. And that's why you see people in different positions, because it doesn't automatically happen. The only way it happens is when we choose to take those thoughts captive, make them obey the word of God. Take that scenario captive and make it obey the word of God. And then when it gets in your thoughts, Philippians 4 tells us to think on these things: whatever things are true, lovely, of good report. Those are the things that we're to think on. So if it doesn't fit in that category, if this thought, thing happening, trouble, does not fit in that category, first we believe the best, we believe the best outcome. Now, if it's not true, lovely, of good report, praiseworthy, I'm not going to think on it. I'm not going to dwell on it. Our mind likes to make it like a movie camera and replaying it over and over and over and over. It keeps you up at night. You can't sleep. It just replays it over and over. I'm telling you right now, if it doesn't fit that criteria, and maybe you need to write this. Actually, write it in the comments. Write it on a cue card for yourself. If it's not true, lovely, of good report, or praiseworthy. That's our filter. True, lovely, good report, praiseworthy. I'm not going to dwell on it. You can reject it. Isn't that incredible? You don't have to think on it. You don't have to dwell on it. You can reject that thought. Light bulb here. Just because the devil delivers something to your door does not mean you have to open that package, and you certainly don't have to play with that package, entertain it, and deal with it and dwell on it. You take that the thought captive first by paying attention the way you're receiving it, and then whether you're going to dwell on it or not. And if it's not, it's simply, I'm not going to think on that. I'm not going to pay it any attention. I'm not going to give it any real estate in my brain. I don't have to. And then, I know it's not as easy as it sounds. Trust me, this is one that takes deep practice. This isn't just drawing back and swinging again. This one takes breaking this down so simply and making sure we're moment by moment. Because listen, you can say, oh, I'm not going to think about that in 1 second. And the next second, here you are thinking about it again. Isn't it amazing how that happens? When that happens, again, you don't have to receive it a second time. You don't have to take it. You can say, no, I said I wasn't going to dwell on that. And you know what the best thing is to replace it with thinking on something good. So you might have to look up some scriptures that counteract that. And when that thought comes in, you're going to quote those scriptures. Sometimes it's not enough to say it in your mind. Sometimes you actually have to say it out loud. Because when I'm talking out loud is the only way I can overtake the thoughts in my mind. Because if you're just thinking on it, somehow it's just like, takes control there. Pastor Lorna, can I have you come up here? And here, we're going to use this coffee, not that coffee's bad, as an example of the enemy coming in with something bad and trying to give it to us. So you just keep trying to give that to me. No, thank you. And look at this is how our thoughts are. When you determine you're not going to think on that negative thing, This is what the enemy does. He doesn't stop. He does different levels. Look at, he comes in from every direction. Oh, maybe if I come in, she was just like, maybe if I come in from behind her, she's not going to see this. Come on now. You know those thoughts. No. In some days, it's that moment by moment, moment by moment. But the victory comes when you now replace that with the word of God says, here's the enemy trying to give me something I don't want. Let's just say my God shall supply all of my needs is the scripture that I have to combat that with. I'm going to now speak. It is written. Like, this is how Jesus combated in the wilderness. The thoughts, the temptations that the enemy tried to bring to him. You replace it with the word of God. You declare what the word of God says. And you just declare, it is written. It is written. It is written every single time. And listen. The enemy has to flee. The word of God says, submit to God, starts with submit to God, resist the devil, and then he will flee. You have to resist. And again, listen, you are not a weak person and you are not bad because the devil's nagging. Nope. Him and his henchmen, they're assigned 24/7 to steal, kill, and destroy. It's their job. It's what they do. But you don't have to buy into it. So now you've taken that thought. You've stopped the way that you perceive it when it comes in. You've done the checklist. Is this lovely? Is this good? And if it's not, I'm going to reject it. And then after you reject it, you replace it with the word of God and you declare the word of God, because now your pen, your tongue is the pen of a ready writer, and you're writing what's actually going to happen, what's actually going to be seen, and then you get to walk in that harvest when you choose to do that. So now you've literally taken that thought captive, and you've made it obey the word of God. But it takes action. And listen, you can say, oh, I know that scripture. I know, take every thought captive. That's the very enemy of your victory. I know is the enemy of your victory. Action is the answer. God is calling us to be doers. The word of God says that we are not to be hearers only, but to be doers of the word of God. It is not enough just to hear. It says if you are a hearer only and not a doer, that you deceive yourself. And isn't that what happens? And that's how we can get in a rut. And that's how we can get in a bad place. And that's how we can get stuck for years in, because we've heard the word of God. We've even said, amen. I like that verse. That's so good. We've said that, but we haven't actually done the action. So the next thought that comes to you, you're going to change the way that you've received it. You're going to change what you've done in the past. And that's going to take exerted effort on your behalf. So this is your job and your assignment, to take every thought captive. That's not a suggestion from God. If you want to walk in victory, it's not going to fall out of the sky. It's not going to land in your lap. The enemy's certainly not bringing you a wheelchair to push you through that thing. It's not going to happen unless you exert the effort and the energy to change what you've been doing. But when you choose to change, you will then advance through in victory every single day. But it takes action. The Lord went to the lame man that was laying there, and he spoke to him, pick up your bed and walk. He had to do something to get the victory. He had to obey the word of God, do the word of God, or he'd just be deceiving himself. The Lord said, pick up your bed and walk. Get up. So I'm telling you right now, get up and walk. Get up and walk right out of that situation. Get up and walk right out of that scenario. Get up and walk right out of that sickness. Get up and walk right out of that disease. Don't stay there. Don't stay in that stuck place. Don't stay in that depressed place. Don't stay in that anxiety. Don't stay in that fear. Whatever you've been doing in the past, we're going to change what we've been doing. We're going to break it all the way down. And we're going to do what the Word of God says. And when we choose to do and act on the Word, then we will walk in victory. Then we will have peace. Then we will have joy. That's the way to practically break it down. So another, let's back the thoughts up again. So there's even another step that we can take on taking every thought captive. Let's talk about before the thought even comes at you. Let's get at it before that. So when you wake up in the morning, early in the morning will I direct my prayers. Early in the morning. So start first thing in the morning, declaring what your thoughts will be. David told his soul what it was allowed to think. Start before the thought even comes. I mean, this is like we're breaking it all the way down to super, super practical so that you can have victory in your thought life. And this is just one area. We're going to talk about a bunch more. This is one area in your thought life. Rewind even before the thing comes and start your day with declaring that I will think on the things that are lovely, true, good report, praiseworthy. I'm going to declare what I'm allowed to think on, what I will dwell on, what I'm going to put in my spirit. Start your day with praise. Start your day with praise and worship. You know, worship is awesome and it's deep and it's amazing, but there is something about praise. Praise will bring breakthrough. Praise causes chains to fall off. Praise causes prison doors to swing wide open and set people free. Get praise in your spirit. It will literally shift and change the atmosphere. Praise shifts and changes the atmosphere that you're in, the atmosphere that's around you, the atmosphere that you carry. Did you know that you're carrying an atmosphere into a room? Whatever it is you have, you're carrying that into a room. Is your atmosphere filled with depression, anxiety, fear, doubt, discouragement? If we don't start at this really practical spot, sometimes that's what automatically is going to happen. Because unless we change what we've always done, it's going to be the automatic. And listen, I don't want to be carrying that stuff around. And I know you don't want to carry that around. God didn't die on the cross for you to carry that around. John 10:10 says, I have come that you might have life and life more abundantly. Jesus Christ died on the cross so that you can have fun. So that you can smile. And you can laugh and you can have joy amidst all these things in the middle of the fire. Jesus Christ died and paid the price on the cross so that you can have this victory every single day in every battle and anything that you're facing. You can walk in victory, but you've got to change what you've been doing. Type it in the comments. I'm going to change it. 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 Because if you don't actually change what you're doing, you're going to be the same person that you've been. You're going to be in the same place. And you're here today. And you paid money. And you're participating so that you can advance in victory. We're going to advance in victory. And we're going to do that by changing what we're going to take action. We're not going to be hearers only, Lord. We're going to be doers of your word. Hearing is not enough because we deceive ourselves. That's in James 1, 22 through 24. I'm going to read that in the Amplified version. So if you have your Bible, go ahead and turn there. Again, write this down in your notes. These are important passages. The scripture is what will cut those things off. When you read it and when you hear it and when you act on it. So James 1:22. I'm almost there. Here we go. Oh, let's turn to the Amplified. Okay, here we go. Be doers of the word. Obey the message and do not merely listen to it. Betraying yourself into deception by reasoning contrary to the truth. For if anyone only listens to the word without it obeying it and being a doer of it, he is like a man who looks carefully at his own natural face in a mirror, for he thoughtfully observes himself and then goes off promptly and forgets what he is like. But he who looks carefully into the faultless law of liberty and is faithful to it and perseveres in looking into it, being not a heedless listener who forgets, but an active doer. Type in there, I am an active doer. I am an active doer. Listen to what it says. This is your promise. When you're an actor, this is a promise. You can go to the bank with it. You can say to your circumstance, the Bible says, it is written, if I am an active doer, he shall be blessed in his doing. He shall be blessed in his doing. We want to be blessed in what we do. We want God's favor on us. And it tells us the ingredient to do that right here. When you're an active doer of the word of God, his blessings are going to show up in your life. If anyone thinks of himself to be religious, piously observant of the external duties of his faith, and does not bridle his own tongue, but deludes his own heart, this person's religious service is worthless. It's futile and it's barren. I know it though. I know, Pastor Rhonda, that's fruitless, worthless, and barren. Knowing it is not, listen, the devil knows the Bible. The devil knows the Bible. It is not enough to just know it. Right here, he tells us we must be active doers, and then the blessing of God shows up. If we're not active doers, our actions are worthless, futile. It's not even worth it. It's going to keep you in that barren, desolate place. It's going to keep you from abundant life. It's going to keep you from God's blessing. So you may have been shaking your head, man, I thought I was doing everything right. I'm reading my Bible. I'm going to church. I'm hearing. God is saying he needs you to act on the word of God to a new level. We're taking it to a new level. We're going to start action in every area of our life and then watch God bless you and cause you to be victorious in everything that you do. And then Matthew 7:24. We're going to turn there. This is that passage that I love so much. Matthew 7:24. Write it down. Matthew 7:24. Again, this is the Bible. This is the word of God. It's not enough to just go by what you know or what you knew or what you've heard. You know, when you open this fresh and new, this isn't ink on a page. This is God speaking to you. Life. It's quick. It's powerful. So even if you've read the same scripture 500 times, when you open it, it's the fresh word of God speaking to you again. It is fresh and new and powerful for that moment. So don't ever say, I know, or don't ever think, I know what the word of God says. One of the times I was in the hospital, I got this awful report and just my immediate reaction was to break down and crumble up and give up and quit. But after that 30-second breakdown is all I gave it, I immediately was like, I need healing scriptures. I need to know what the word of God says. So I pulled out my healing scriptures. I had to do an action. It wasn't enough. I listened to the healing scriptures at least twice a day. There's 101 of them that I go over. I'm listening to those night and day. I know what they say. I have them memorized. I can quote them to you. I can almost quote all 101 to you. But it's not enough just to know what they say. You have to actually act on it and physically do it. So in that moment, even though I know it, I had all that stuff. My first reaction was freaking out. And I was freaking out until I got the word of God out and I started read. I actually played it. So I was listening to it and I was reading it as they were saying it out loud. Because you need to take over your thoughts in those moments. You need to get control of your thoughts. And sometimes listening, your thoughts can still take over. So I didn't just listen. I read the word of God. So it was an action that I had to do. And listen, as soon as I did that, the word of God became life and it was a scalpel for me. And my faith was restored to me. So we have to actually act on the word of God. So Matthew 7, verse 24 in the Amplified says, "So everyone who hears these words of mine and acts upon them." How have we been missing this part for so long? It is not enough just to hear a sermon. It's not enough to hear a message. It's not enough to hear a teaching. It's not enough to hear the word of God. He's telling us hearing and acting. We have got to put action to our feet, action to our mouth, action to our mind, action to our hands. He who hears these words of mine and acts upon them. Listen, this is a promise. This is how you get victory. When you act on the word of God, obeying them, it says, obeying them, not just hearing, actually obeying what the word of God says, he will be like a sensible, prudent, practical, wise man who built his house upon a rock. When you are acting on the word of God, you are standing on solid rock, not sinking sand. It does not matter what happens around you. You are on solid rock. This is your promise. It doesn't matter what troubles presented, what statement, what circumstance, what it is. Circumstances do not dictate your results. Do not dictate your victory. It's the word of God, and you're acting on the word of God that will determine your victory every single day. And the rain fell, because in this world, the rain falls on the just and the unjust alike. The rain fell. The floods came. Whew. Isn't that how it goes? It doesn't just rain. Now it's flooding. And the winds blew. Now the wind is blowing. The winds just didn't blow. They beat against that house. So now all hell's breaking loose. The rain is falling. Flood waters are overtaking you. The wind is blowing. It's beating upon your house. Yet it did not fall because it had been founded upon the rock. When I'm experiencing all those things, I remind myself what to think. I remind myself, you're on solid rock, Rhonda. You're on solid rock. You cannot fall. You're not on sinking sand. You're on solid rock. I want you to tell yourself, I am standing on solid rock. When the rain's falling and all hell's breaking loose in front of you and everything's happening, and you can't keep your earbud in, when the rains fall and the winds blow and the floods come and they're beating upon the rock, you just say, I am standing on solid rock. I cannot fall. It's the word of God. It's the promise of the word of God. If I am acting on the word of God, it's his responsibility that I cannot fall. I'm on solid rock. I don't care what's happening. When I've done everything to stand, you'll see me still standing right here on this solid rock. I become immovable. I cannot fail. You can't fail in that situation. That's what it says. But then there's another side to this. And too many people live on this other side. Everyone who hears these words of mine. So they're people that hear the word. The same word that person that acted heard. They hear the same word. And does not do them. He will be like a stupid, foolish man who built his house upon sand. And then when the rains come and the floods came and the winds blew and beat upon that house, it fell. And great and complete was the fall of it. It's our choice. Whether we stand on sinking sand or solid rock has nothing to do on our circumstances or what hell you've been dealt or what's going on around you. It's dependent on you obeying and acting on the word of God. But when you choose to do it, I know it's contrary to everything that's out there. It's contrary to everything anybody would tell you. The word of God is contrary against our flesh nature and our soulish realm. It is enmity. There is a war that goes on. But when we choose to act on the word of God, you are on solid rock. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care how impossible it is. God is the God of the impossible, and you will see him do the impossible when you act on his word. You get to see miracles. You get to see the impossible. It's an exciting place to live, acting on the word of God. But we've got to practice. We've got to do it. It's not enough just to know. It's not even enough to just preach it. I could stand up here and preach it all and not live it myself, and I wouldn't have any more victory than the next person. But I choose to not live that way. I choose to act on what the word of God says. I don't care what anybody else does. I'm going to walk in the abundant life that Jesus Christ purchased for me. I'm not going to throw it away and toss it aside like it's insignificant. Jesus Christ paid the price for your victory. We are disrespecting the cross when we're not walking in victory. We're disrespecting this great price that was paid. God desires his children to be blessed and to walk in victory. That's what you're supposed to have. Victorious living. You're a child of the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Almighty God, where nothing is impossible. He says, if you earthly fathers know how to give to your children, how much more your heavenly Father knows how to give. He wants you to walk in victory. He paid the price for it. So we need to act on the word. We talked about taking every thought captive. Here's another area that we need to act on the word of God. And there's lots. So open your Bible and just start acting on it. But I'm going to go through some big ones. Do you know that your Bible says, do good to those who curse you? Bless them that despitefully use you. I know. But have you done it? Have you done something good for that person? It's not enough. It doesn't just say pray for them. I'm praying for them. Nope. Do good to them. Bless them that curse you. Listen, when we choose not to act on the word of God, that bitterness grows inside. And it separates us from the active power of God. It puts us on sinking sand. That's why he tells us to act on it, because he doesn't want us in that place. He wants us in the place of victory. It's what he paid for. It's what he wants for us. But we need to actually do the word of God. Do good. Do something good. Buy a gift card. Send it anonymously in the mail. Send a card that says a nice blessing anonymously in the mail. It's not for them. It's not for them. It's for you. It's for you to be on solid. Man, I would do anything in the middle of the storm to be on solid rock. I would do anything in the middle of the storm to know that I can't fail and I cannot fall, and to have the blessing and the favor of God and the presence of God to go with me. I don't want to do anything that will take me out of that place, but not doing something is still action. It's still a choice. It's a choice that's going to keep all hell breaking loose. It's going to keep the power of God from being active in your life. It's going to keep sinking sand under your feet. So we actually have to choose to do something differently than what we've done before. And I know, like, these are all scriptures we've all heard before. But have we actually done them? It says to quickly forgive and let it go. Quickly forgive and let it go. Let the matter drop. the word of God says that when we don't, that scripture that says, be angry and sin not, the scripture right after that talks about giving the devil a foothold. Having unforgiveness gives the devil a foothold in our life. I want you to hear me so clear, because I think this is like the accepted sin in the church. The Bible says, if you don't forgive, my Father cannot forgive you. That means you're not going to heaven. I don't care if you're a pastor or a preacher or who you are, an evangelist, the biggest healing, whatever you've got. If you don't forgive, you cannot be forgiven. And when you choose not to forgive, it gives the devil a foothold. And do you know that the devil never takes a foothold? Anybody ever experienced that in your life? He never takes the foothold that he's given. He comes in and takes over the whole house. You think, oh, it's just such a little thing. It's just, no, that's the foothold. That's the crack that the enemy comes in. He's taking over the whole house. All hell is breaking loose in your life when you walk in unforgiveness. So we've got to actually act. I would encourage you right now to act quickly and forgive anyone you have aught against. It could be your brother and sister in church. It could be that person that didn't even know they hurt you. It could be that person that hurt you on purpose. It could be just a downright evil person that's out to hurt you. Forgive quickly. Forgive quickly. Forgive quickly. Let it go. Don't talk about it. Don't dwell on it. Just let it go. Well, I'm letting them off the hook. No, you're not. You're letting yourself off the hook. The hook to that thing that keeps you anchored down, that keeps you in bondage, that keeps you broken, that keeps you on sinking sand. See how knowing is not enough? We've got to actually change what we've been doing and act on the word of God. When you hear a word from God, I want you to immediately think, how can I act on this? From now on, I pray every time you hear a word from God, you're opening the Bible, you're in a sermon, a pie, whatever it is, God, how can I act on this? And start acting on it. Because when we act on the word of God, whoo, you're so sure-footed. It doesn't matter what's going on around you, fire, wind, waves, whatever. You're just sipping your tea, walking in victory. Peace, joy, love, those are all your portion. Blessing, favor, all that's going to happen in your life. But it's not when we don't choose to obey the word of God. His word is the one that's saying, I'm not saying this to you. This is what his word says. I've read you the scripture. It's his word. Here we go. Praise in the prison. Praise in the prison. You just feel like you're stuck. You can't get those metal bars in front of you. You can't seem to advance. Praise. Crank up that praise music. Put on your high heels and get to dancing. I mean, seriously. I'm serious. Like, actually do it. It's not enough to know it and think about it. You actually have to do it. But when you do it, when you choose to praise in the prison, then the chains come off. Then those bars are sawed in half and you're set free. Then, but you actually have to put action to the word of God. And we have to be examples to the believers. Where are the examples out there? Where are the examples? The world needs the examples. In these last days, we've got to be the example more than ever. They need the answer, and you have the answers. We've got to be the example. Peace in the storm. Peace in the storm. Be anxious for nothing. Philippians, be anxious for nothing. And then the peace of God will rule in your hearts and minds. It's not a suggestion. God is commanding you to be anxious for nothing. There's nothing in this world that you should be fretting over, that you should be worrying about. When we choose to trust, rely on that scripture, Proverbs 3:5, lean not on your own understanding, trust the Lord with all of your heart. When we choose to do that, it says, then the peace of God which passes all understanding, will rule in your heart and mind. Peace is our portion. Peace. I speak right now peace to the storms in your life. You speak it over your life. When stuff gets really tumultuous around me, I'll speak right out loud. Peace be still. Peace be still. Peace be still. When you start feeling anxiety and fear coming on you, just speak to your soul. Peace be still. Peace. It's the word of God. And then fix your eyes on Jesus. Again, none of this stuff is suggestion. It's what the word of God tells us to do. We're not supposed to be fixed on all the negative and all the bad things that are going on. Turn off the news. Turn it off. Fix your eyes on Jesus. We're kingdom anyways. Right. What effect does the news have on me? What effect does what going on in the world have to do on me? No, I'm a kingdom citizen. You're a kingdom citizen. We don't walk according to this world. We don't walk according. I don't care what happens in this world. What you get to walk in is the kingdom of God. And in the kingdom of God is wholeness, is peace, is love, is joy, is everything that you need for life and godliness. Everything. The kingdom of God is the blessed life. You get to walk in that. You're to fix your eyes on Jesus. Fix your eyes on that. Fix them. Keep straight ahead. And you know, I know something will happen. It'll get you distracted and look in when there's a flash of something. It draws your attention away. It's okay. Just put your fixer back right on Jesus. There's something going. No. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Continuously fix your eyes on Jesus. Okay. Yes. Amen. So I want you to practice. And you know, these things don't change overnight. Don't expect yourself just to be good at all of that overnight. And when you take it on too big, what's the quote that says, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. So you're just going to do one action at a time. Just the next thing that comes up, I'm going to walk in victory. Whatever the next thing is, I'm going to walk in victory. Whatever the next thing is, I'm going to walk in victory. And all of a sudden, you're going to see yourself walking in victory a whole day. A whole day walking in victory. Then you're going to be a whole week. Then you're going to be a whole month. And then you're going to be a whole lifetime walking in victory. But it comes from action. To the word of God, breaking it down and actually choosing to do something different. We're breaking off our old ways. We're breaking off our old habits. We're breaking off what automatically happens. The only way to break off what automatically happens is to change what we are doing. Amen. We're going to go into question and answer. Go ahead and put your Q&As up on the chat and we will take those as they come.
Wow.
Jesus. We'll give you a minute to put up your questions.
Yes.
Ooh, I'm going to expect some big things from you ladies.
I'm going to expect, man, listen, how many? We have almost 100 women on this. Wow, wow, wow. The things that you are going to do. Just by your, you know what? It's not even that you have to do great, big, huge things. Just live your life in victory is the most powerful testimony and impact that you can have. If you live your life in everyday victory, you're going to change the world. You're going to change the world. Go ahead with your questions.
I know this has been just so, you're probably like, oh my God, this is so much. Like God is doing so much and speaking so much all at once, you know? And the fact is we've had a lot of sermons. We've, and you know, I know we don't even really we've been doing virtual stuff for so long now because of the situations that we're in. I think people kind of just, you know, we hearing all these words, we're going from stream to stream, clicking on this preacher and that preacher, and wondering why people are still not living in that victory. But it's this very thing that you're talking about today is an application, practicing, doing, actually living this thing. Like, I mean, the word of God being the final say in our life. There's been too much of, I know God's word says this, but that's that I know. Mm-hmm. I know God's word says this, but this is what they say on CNN or whatever.
Right.
But what it should not even be, I know God's word says, but it should be, everything in our life has to line up with the word, period.
Amen.
I mean, dare I say it? Political things, yeah, everything,
absolutely.
Everything. If we're aligning ourselves with things outside of the word of God, I'm telling you with everything in me, many people are sick and die, like the scripture says,
yeah.
That's because we are not discerning the Lord's body. We're not honoring his word.
Yeah.
And so then we said, well, sister so-and-so died.
Yeah.
So if she died and she was a pillar in the church, then, you know, it's possible I could die too. No, because we don't know how she was. She might not have been practicing the word, really getting it in her and living that or whatever that may be. We don't know that. That's between them and the Lord.
Yeah.
They have everybody has a free will.
Yeah. Yeah,
we have to. It doesn't matter what happens in anybody else's life.
Circumstances.
The word is the final authority.
Amen. Okay, there's a question.
We have a question.
In this COVID time, where the reality of some unchurched cannot see or feel victory, we are saying advance. But what do you see as a foundation and first impact to help the outside see God's victory during this pandemic? Awesome, awesome question. I feel like in this time, the church shines the brightest of all. I mean, seriously, letting them see your life of victory is such a testimony. And in that, it's faith. Faith is the first thing that we need to do and have. Like, we preach the word of God. But it seems like with the pandemic, it's like, oh, well, COVID, it doesn't apply to. I'm sorry. The word of God applies in every season. And listen to me, church. This is persecution. And it's not going to get better. We've got to learn how to stand according to the word of God, no matter what's going on. We've got to stand up for what the word of God says, and the faith, the word of God says that no sickness or disease can befall our household, that we are protected from every single one of those things. But COVID, does it say it in there? No, it actually says in one passage that any sickness, or even the ones that haven't even been named yet, he has healed and protected us from. Like, we need, that's the message that we need to preach. Do we not believe it? Do we not believe that God protects us from anything and everything? I know a few years back, I went into South Africa and went, I want to know the right term to call it. I'll call it a tent city. It's where, like, abject poverty, they hold up cardboards and that kind of stuff. And sickness and disease is rampant in those places. I didn't think a thing of it. I went in to the worst of the worst, laid hands on them, and prayed for them to recover.
Yes.
That was just a few years ago. So do I act differently when it's COVID? Like, I'm not afraid of it because I know what the word of God says. Listen, church, we can't change the word of God based on circumstances and scenarios, even if it's a political slant to it, because the word of God is true, and we can't be afraid of what's coming at us. The word lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. We don't fear those things. I have the same faith that I did when I went into those tent cities with rampant disease all around that I do with today's current thing. We need to stand according to the word of God. Things in the end times are going to get worse and worse. And listen, love. Can I just say love? Love covers. Love heals. Faith works by love. It's one of the biggest, this is an action one. So I'm glad we're on this. This is an action one. Faith works by love. Our faith is broken because love in this world today is broken. The word of God also says in the end times, the love of many will wax cold. And I mean this on all fronts. The love of many has waxed cold. Let it not be from any of us. Love has been broken, mask, no mask. I mean, whatever stand you have, it's fine. Like, it's fine if you want to wear a mask and you believe that it protects you, that's fine, wear them. But if you're a person that doesn't wear a mask and you don't want to, then don't. It's fine. You don't hate the other party. And I'm talking to both sides right here. I'm talking to both sides. Why is it that we have to hate our brothers and sisters because they've chose to do something different? When did that happen? Where it got our love got replaced with hatred? Like, when did that happen? Because I like pink and you like purple, I now have to hate you because we don't like the same color? And if you don't like my pink, then I don't like you because you don't like... What? What on earth is happening? Republican and Democrat. I'm talking both sides right now. Come on. Why can't I have a differing party than my friend? The love of many has waxed cold. And this is what is keeping the church sick, broken, powerless, ineffective in our community. I'm telling you, love. Love is the number one thing above everything else. Love. Jesus teaches us love in 1 Corinthians 13. Do that as your homework. Go through and read it. Read it in the Amplified Classic. Break it down. Read it every single day. And then don't just read it and know it. Act on it, because it says love believes the best. Love keeps no records of wrong. Love pays it no attention to a suffered wrong. Like, let's bring love back to our world. You know what? That's the number one thing. I would say that's our first step in this whole thing, is to bring love. Preach that message of love. Stop hating. I mean, this is like people that I love have hatred towards me in this divide. And it's a big divide because people are made uniquely different. And people's opinions and perceptions are different. We can look at the exact same picture and I'll see something and you might see something different. And that's okay. That's okay. We're called to love everyone. To love them all. And not to judge because they're different than we are. What if we just loved people? Just loved them. Oh, I'm talking both sides. Stop thinking in your brain, yeah, that's what they need to do. No, you need to do it too. This is action that we're talking about today. Love, love. Faith works by love. If your love walk is broken in any manner, and the love of many is going to wax cold. So I know many love walks are broken. That means faith is not working.
That's why people are dying.
I mean, seriously, this is crazy because it's people that have been in the gospel for many years. I mean, saved people. Like, it's crazy. The love of many is waxing cold. We've got to get our love walk fixed. And then our faith walk is going to be, wow, the world is going to look in and be like, they're unstoppable. There's nothing their God won't do for them.
Wow. I like that. Look, are you picking up what Pastor Rhonda is putting down?
Maria, you're posting exactly what I'm talking about. Within the church, if you wear a mask, some people don't think you have enough faith. And that makes some people insecure in church worshiping. Listen, we need to mind our neck, as the young people teach me. That means look at yourself.
Yes.
Don't worry about what anybody else is doing. And don't judge. And for goodness sake, I just heard of somebody in the church actually condemning to their face people wearing masks. You know what? Mind your own business. They can do whatever they choose to do, and you can do whatever you choose to do. It's, you know what? For some people, wearing a mask is a sign of honor. I'm not saying it always has to be, and you have to wear one because it's a sign of honor. Don't you worry. You hold your head high with whatever God is telling you to do, mm-hmm. and you keep your heart clean, and you stay in love, and then the power, listen, they're going to be able to deny the power of God, the blessing and the favor of God. Man, she's wearing a mask in church every single Sunday, and look at the blessing of God and the favor of God showing up in every area of her life. They won't be able to deny it then. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about what other people think. It doesn't matter what other people think. Your love walk is what matters.
Well, so right now we're going to go have a 5-minute break, and we're going to come back, and we got some more fun stuff. We have an opportunity for you to win a $150 gift card with something that is in your conference box that you're going to need, that paper plate and that marker. Okay. So 5 minutes, come right back. Don't get distracted. Do whatever you need to do and come right back, okay? All right, we'll see you in 5 minutes.